Joe Cool and the rest of the Peanuts characters live here at Number One Snoopy Place, in a quiet town of Santa Rosa, California, just an hour's drive north of San Francisco. In this book-lined studio, filled with nearly a half century of memorabilia, family, and of fellow artists from around the world, Charles Schulz weaves his daily magic. From this solitary easel, armed with just pencil, pen, and blank paper, Charles Schulz has been a bell ringer for our thoughts and imagination. Within a few inches of space, and with just a few seconds of time, he is at once an artist, a humorist, and often a philosopher. Did you always want to be a cartoonist?
Someone wrote to me recently and was wondering about a strip that I had done years ago where Linus was drawing in the air. And this person was wondering if I had gotten the idea from some educator whom she mentioned. And of course, I had never heard of this person, but I had forgotten that when I was small, I used to draw in the air all of the time. I'd be sitting around like some stupid little kid while others were talking. The adults were carrying on a conversation. I had nothing to do, and I'd be drawing pictures in the air. They probably thought I was crazy. And then we also had a kitchen table which had some kind of a smooth material where I could draw on it with a pencil and then it could be washed off. I'll bet I made thousands of drawings on the top of that kitchen table and then just washed them all away because it made up for a lack of drawing paper. I was always stuck for good drawing paper. And I remember a kid showing me some drawings that he had made on his notebook for school. It never occurred to me to do that. I just didn't think that people cared about drawing that much. And I looked at this notebook that he had drawn on, and I thought, I can do even better than that. And so I started drawing on the cover of my notebooks, and then all the other kids in class saw Mickey Mouse and the Three Little Pigs and Popeye and those things on my notebooks, and then I had to draw on their notebooks, too. I guess that's when autographs started.
Because he excels in art and other subjects as well, Charles Schulz is promoted, jumped ahead, two elementary grades. Because of his rapid promotion, he's suddenly the youngest in his class, so he's either ignored or rebuffed by the older, bigger children. He becomes a loner, often working alone, playing alone, and even eating lunch alone in the schoolyard.
I remember a problem that I gave the class. To draw small objects in groups of threes. Some of the pupils could produce maybe, oh, three or four groups. Charles filled a whole sheet of 12 by 18 of drawings so crowded. And they were spectacular because there were things that you wouldn't even think of. That means that his mind is working every minute. He isn't worried about what's going on the paper. It's in his mind. It's got to come out. And from that time on, I just kept my hands off. And that feeling that comes from Charles is really part of his soul. I think that's why he is still a shy man. He's expended so much of himself into his drawings. And I still don't understand how he does as much as he does.
Too discouraged to seek a formal education after high school, he enrolls in a correspondence school of art instruction. Then, after an army tour of duty in Europe during World War II, he returns to St. Paul, Minnesota to try to find a job as an artist. For over a year, he's turned down time and time again. Finally, a St. Paul newspaper starts to run his comic panel called Little Folks as a once-a-week feature in the late 1940s. In 1950, he bundles his best work and sends it to United Feature Syndicate in New York. To his amazement, United buys the strip, renames it Peanuts, and sells it to 8 newspapers. Today, 40 years later, Peanuts appears daily in 2,200 newspapers around the world. How many times have we cuddled a Snoopy doll, or pinned a Peanuts comic strip on a wall, or smiled knowingly at our child security blanket? How many times have we yelled good grief or thought that happiness really is a warm puppy? How many times have we wished that poor Charlie Brown would kick that football or fly that kite or win that baseball game? And how many times have we gathered our family in front of the television to watch a Charlie Brown Christmas? It was that TV special back in 1965 that brought movement and voices to the by then 15-year-old comic strip, translating what by then had become the nation's favorite strip to primetime television was a difficult assignment for animator Bill Melendez.
These little kids have such great big heads, we couldn't reach around to touch the top of their heads. So we never could animate them in that, you know, reaching for anything in the front view. We always had to turn them profile so then we could stretch our arm as long as we wanted. But we didn't find that out until we started trying to animate. And another little thing was how do they walk? It's easy enough to say, well, we'll just walk them across a room. But they have little tiny legs. It's this great big head, a little tiny body.
Don't know.
And we had to decide, you know, how fast to walk them. The best thing we thought of and came up with was to use children's voices. Again, that helped make the little characters convincingly real.
Prior to A Charlie Brown Christmas, most cartoons involving children had used adult voices pretending to be children. But from their first special, the Peanuts kids have always been played by children ranging from age 6 to 12. Every 2 years, a new cast must be found. Recently, over 50 of those voices, now ranging in age from 6 to 36, met at Camp Snoopy at Knott's Berry Farm in California for the 25th television anniversary celebration, including 8 Charlie Browns.
Oh, good grief!
I remember about being the first voice of Charlie Brown being in a very cold recording studio. No, it was a wonderful experience. I was a child actor, so doing the voice of Charlie Brown was a lot easier because he didn't have to wear makeup. And it was just a lot of fun.
Hi, my name's Aaron Chase, and I was the first girl to play Charlie Brown. And this is American Charlie Brown.
It was my first voiceover I ever did, my first cartoon, and it was a lot of fun. It was just great. It was always neat for me to say that I was Charlie Brown. And my friends today, they still don't believe me. I can say to them, I was Charlie Brown. And they say, do the voice. But I can't do the voice anymore. The voice changed. I was out of there. But it was a lot of fun.
And amongst a dozen former Lucys was Sally Dreyer, who was Lucy back in 1966.
I guess it's amazing to me how much of Lucy's personality I've taken on. I really enjoyed playing Lucy. I got a lot of attention when I was a kid.
Well, I most remember is when I went into audition, I was all nervous and stuff, and my mom just told me, Heather, just act like you're talking to your brother. And so I went in and I just talked all snotty and nasally and, you know, just acted like I was talking to my big brother. And sure enough, I got the job.
You're a blockhead, Charlie Brown!
My name is Jeff Warnstein. I played Pigpen on A Charlie Brown Christmas, and it's followed me all my life.
All I remember is we had a major blast while filming. All of us had fun, always playing around.
I played Peppermint Patty a long time ago. An odd thing that comes about when you do play Peppermint Patty, I work construction during the day, and I had to ask for today off, which is Friday. So I asked my foreman for some unknown reason that I had to show up here today, not because I was Peppermint Patty.
You gotta like me, don't you, Chuck? You fly dog! Happy birthday!
In a fairly well-guarded secret all these years, one voice did belong to an adult. Bill Melendez as Snoopy.
Got it. Now you play it back at double speed.
Well, what do you think of my routine, Coach? A roller skating coach is as crabby as you.
As the years went by, we found it proper and timely to elaborate on our use of the medium. So we entered into rotoscoping, where we animate the character directly over live action.